You have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. God will be at 4:30 this morning and change the message. He gave me 15 points. Literally. Y'all about to see a miracle. My wife said, honey, if you have to preach 15 points in 45 minutes. I said, I can preach 2 points in 45 minutes. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Will you find it, would you stand with me, and I'll be reverent to the reading of God, holy and powerful word. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Verse 8, love never fails. Father, we come to you grateful and thankful for this day, for this word. And I thank you for getting me up early this morning, Father, and changing my heart. And I pray now, Father, that through the word of God and by a movement of the Holy Ghost, Father, that you would breathe into us new life. And Father, you would challenge our hearts and our lives in the area of love. May you do great and mighty things because you're a great and mighty God. We surrender this time to you and ask you to simply have your way. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. The nation in which we live is struggling greatly with the lack of love. And it's our responsibility. Look at your neighbor and say, it's our fault. It's our responsibility to be the example of genuine love. God's love. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 and 8 says this. Beloved, now he's speaking to us. There's no mistake here he's talking to. He's not talking to a lost world, and he's not talking to humanity and human reasoning and human emotions based on humanism. He is speaking to the children of God. He says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. Amen. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God. Listen to what he said. For God is love. There is no doubt that God is the author of love. It is the attribute that defines the very nature and the character of who God is. The Bible says in John 3:16 that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. In Romans, it said that God put his love on display, that in, while we were yet sinners, he gave his life for us so that our ransom could be paid. God, in his own divine nature, is the epitome of love. Matter of fact, John says, you don't even know what love is until you know this God. Because he's the author, he's the creator of it. He is embodied by love. And so John writes and tells us that we ought to love because we have the love of God in us. The reason I say our nation is struggling is because this nation is supposedly made up of evangelical Christians, a large percentage of it. And yet I see Christians acting the same way that people that don't have love act. And that ought not be. So Paul this morning in our text describes God's love And remember, he is describing this love. The need for this sermon is because in the church of Christ, there's division. There's become bitterness and anger. There's become frustration and division in the church. And so Paul's got to write a letter and remind the church of the very nature by which we operate and should live our lives. And that is through the nature of God Himself, who is love. Paul begins to describe to us, and in verse 4, the very first word he used is the word agape. And in this context, Paul uses it in a way that means a love fence. It means benevolence. It means affection. And so Paul's saying the very affection of the children of God, the whole motivation of our lives, we ought to be in a continual love feast. Why? Look up here real quick. Because you're supposed to be having a daily love feast with the God of love. Here's the human mindset concerning love. It's an emotion that must be motivated or stirred up or created by something. God's love is a love feast. He shows us. He displays His love. He gives us His love. I'll show you in just a minute that even salvation is an expression of love. And because we're saved, we have this affection with God, this God of love. And it should make us something. What the world describes as love is nothing but lust. Y'all right. The love of money. The lust of money. The love of power. The lust of power. It's nothing. We painted the emotion of love and we made it into where it is based on some kind of reception or some kind of influence of something. And the truth of the matter is God's love is who He is. He is the author of it.
Right.
Yeah. And John says in 1 John, as a child of God, if you don't possess His love, you can't even be a child of God. So now let's get into the 15 points to learn the love of God. Are you ready? I'm going to speak fast. You got to listen quicker. They're all found right in the text. First of all, Paul begins in verse 4 by describing to us two things, two characteristics of God's love. Look what it says. Love suffers long. The Greek word means to be patient, long in patience, slowness to anger. It means passion. Of course, Paul is speaking of God's patience or long suffering, and he uses it based on us. 2 Peter 3:15 says, and consider that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation. How many of you know our God is a very long and patient God with people? Do you want to know when God showed us His long suffering patience for us? Go back to Noah and the ark. When God set Noah and his family back up, He said, now I'll never destroy man by water again. And it's been thousands of years that God's been putting up with humanity's nonsense. And then it's been thousands of years He's been putting up with His children's nonsense. He does that based on the nature of who He is, the character of who He is. The only thing that's keeping you and I from getting what we rightfully deserve is the love of this God to be patient with us while He does His work. Can I just tell you, not much patience in America. You either like it and do it the way I say do it, or you don't. And by the way, that's crept into the church. Y'all all right? Don't shout me down. We're just on point one. We don't have patience for one another, do we? You live somebody long, you're done with them. Y'all right? I'm doing 99 good things for you, Ron. If I do one bad thing, guess what you have tendency to remember? The one bad thing. Scratch the 99 things done in the love and done in kindness and generosity, and I belong that to my heart for you. Forget that, man. You did one wrong thing. No patience. Was out yesterday handing out carnations. God just, I went from door to door, to house, and people wouldn't come to the door. And then when they come to the door, they look at you kind of strange and funny. And the whole time I'm thinking, well, you know, they ought to be appreciative and show a little bit more, you know, something. And then God said, why, Sam? They don't have this long, patient love. They don't have my love. You're expecting them to do something that they can't do. You're expecting them to react in a way they can't react. They're lost. They don't have my love. They're not motivated by my love. They're not guided by my love. They don't make, they don't pertain. They don't have my love in them. How can they show any patience? Well, I thank God my wife has been patient. And she's put up with me for 40 years, 36 in marriage. Be 37 this year. Thank God she put up with me and just didn't throw me away the first time I messed up. Or the 1,000th time I messed up. Y'all all right? Thank God for God's long-suffering, patient love. You ever seen somebody that said they love you and they got no patience with you? I'm kind of an oxymoron, isn't it? I love you, but I won't kill you right now. Well, is that God's love? No. God doesn't look at you and say, oh, I love you, boy, I wish that phone just smite you. He doesn't act that way. How many of y'all glad for God's patient love with you? Well, hey, by the way, if you raise your hand, look up here. If you raise your hand, then you're expecting. Show that love to others. You grateful? Be so grateful that you pass it on. Some of you husbands and wives, y'all need to get real close and listen to this sermon today. It'll remove the fights and fusses in your house. Y'all all right? Well, I'm preaching better than you, isn't that? You can cover it up close and say, oh, honey, I'm going to start being patient with you. If you give her as much patience as she probably gives you, y'all be all right. Look at the next one. He says, love suffers long and is sometimes kind. Occasionally kind. When you feel like being kind. Is that what your scripture says? Mine says, is. That word kind in the Greek text means here. Listen to this. To show oneself useful. Good nature. It means gentle. Tisdale, in his rendering of this word, means to be courteous. Let me ask you a question. Is our God kind to us?
Yes.
Would you call God's kindness generosity?
Yes.
Would you call it blessings?
Yes.
So when God shows you and I his kindness, we may refer to that as favor, right?
Yes.
We might refer to that as blessing, or his kindness could be considered his generosity. Our God has been very kind to us. If you need proof, just go to the cross and look what he had to bear so that you and I did not bear the wrath of our God. I just love it. How many of y'all are grateful for the kindness of God that he shows upon you each day? Can I ask you a question? Are you as kind to others as God's been to you? Why not? Because you're supposed to be the expression of his love to everybody else. His love lives in you. His love dwells in you. His love is expressed in and through your life and my life every day. So should we be kind to others? Hey, let's just start by being kind to one another. Let's just be courteous to one another. Well, I tell you, we live in a day and time where people are just downright outrageous. Yeah. Inconsiderate, just think about themselves and what they need and what they want. And man, they, you know, I'm going back. I'll show you how inconsiderate we've gotten. All the stores now are putting self-checkouts so that you can get in and get out on your own. Well, you don't have to wait on somebody else to come help you. Amen. Now, that's even done my daughter that. Susan was telling me the other day, you can order online, call 10 minutes prior to getting there, and they'll have it waiting on you. Just so you don't have to show no kindness to other people. Y'all all right? Why do you think we got drive-thrus? That's for people that ain't patient enough to wait on the waitress to bring it to. I was in a hurry. Y'all looking at me mean, strange. Paul begins by telling the church that is lost the focus of God's love, misusing, not representing God's love properly in the context of who God is. And the very first thing he says, you need to understand this love. It is patient, it is long-suffering, and it is kind, generous, courteous. Our God is a gentleman among all gentlemen. Y'all right? Something we'll teach you in a minute. Don't hold the door. Don't wait on the lady. I had a woman the other day at Circle K. She was going to open the door for me. I said, no, ma'am. My daddy come up out of the grave. Me stand and watch a woman hold the door for me. You let me get that door for you and you come in. She looked at me like I was some kind of weirdo. You know why? Because 90% of men would let that woman stand there and hold the door for them and not think a thing of it. Y'all right? Just bust on in there and not worry about waiting for a lady to walk in first. It's amazing how far we've moved. Now watch this. He starts off by saying God's love is a love piece. It suffers long and then it's kind. Then he goes straight into what love's not. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm about to learn what love's not. No, y'all not into this. Look what it said. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. The word here, envy, in the Greek means to be zealous for or against any person or thing. That is to be eager for or against something or somebody. You're against them. You're not for them. God's love is always for us. That should have been a bigger idea. If God be for you, who can be against you? God is for us. He wants us to benefit from his riches and his power and his glory. He wants us to benefit from this love that indwells us. God never has our worst. It is the result of jealousy. Can I tell you, how many of y'all remember the story of Joseph? I was just reading it the other day in Genesis. And you remember how Joseph was, his brothers were jealous of him? Because God gave him the gift to have dreams and to interpret dreams. And then God spoke to him and said, Joseph, you need to tell your daddy, you need to tell your brothers, you need to tell them all that, son, you're going to be it. You're going to be powerful nations about now before you. You're going to represent me among teams. Here he is, the one, the littlest one in the whole pack. And they all got jealous. Envious. Bible says that his daddy loved him more than the others. Well, now you know why his daddy loved him, because he couldn't trust. You can't trust jealous folks. Y'all right? You do know jealousy is a result of lack of trust. I'm not a jealous man. Why? I trust my wife. I don't have to worry about another man, and that I trust my God. I'll pray the wrath of God down on another man. Call up she bears. Killing God. I pray and say, God, I want to be an instrument you use to punish him. I'll give you my old leg, feet, everything. Pray! You don't have to worry about that if you don't. If you trust your wife. All right? Jealousy! Love is not jealous. Got the envy. You ever seen somebody that couldn't stand that they would love? Somebody loved somebody more than they loved him? Not like that. Why is that? Hey, can we just be honest? You mean tell me you can't have affection for somebody a little different than somebody else? Come on, man. I know, you know, I love all my kids the same. I can't get that one that's always obedient, kind, and sweet, you loving them more than you are that one you had to beat 5 times on Sunday. Come on, now. It's a little bit of love. I didn't say you didn't love. I didn't say you didn't love. I just said a little differently. God has to get me sometimes on this. I've been looking at his brother and his church be growing and ministry be just blossoming that thing. And sometimes I get a little envious. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You look at it and you kind of say, wait a minute, God, I study the word. I work, I give, I do all the things that he's doing. And Paul's doing a little better than he is. He's got thousands, I got hundreds. Get a little envious. Then when that brother walks in the room, you put on your Christian face and say, I love you, brother. And the whole time you're thinking, why do you deserve that? Y'all right? You might know what I'm talking about. That's your brother saying, now. I'm not right. I just do mine now. You never drove by a house and said, why do you deserve that? That don't mean time. I got hurt. Love is not envious. Amen. Say it don't envy. So if you've got any envy in your heart, guess what? You don't have the love of God will be in you. Y'all right? All right. Well, let's go to the next one. Love does not parade itself around. Look what he says in verse number 4. He says, love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. The Greek word used here for parade is used nowhere else in the New Testament. It means to boast or brag. It means to elevate oneself above others. Do you know the Bible says that God cannot respect the person that God doesn't like? You ever met somebody that thought they were the top dog? Come on, man, y'all looking like you. You mean there's people out there that just think a lot of themselves? I know some Christians that think they deserve God's love.
Well, if anybody ought to be loved, it ought to be.
Y'all all right? God's gift to all of us. That wasn't just to receive all that love. But you know that people that brag on themselves are insecure. Y'all right? Didn't get no amens there. Somebody's walking around bragging on themselves and always elevating themselves up. They're trying to affirm to themselves that they're better than what they think they are. I'm glad I'm just an old sinner saved by grace. Old country boy don't know no better than just believe. I don't deserve God's love. He showed me his love and kindness toward me. I don't deserve it, man. I never look, I am nothing without him. Apart from him, I am nothing, can't be nothing, will never be anything without God in my life. But boy, I sure have met some preachers that think they're it. I've seen some Sunday school teachers think they're it. I've seen women walk around with their hair long and put down in the bun and wearing the long skirts and they think they've got to get the spirituality to all women. Y'all right? That's not the way God's love works. That's not who God is. God will come to the drunk just like he will this corporate CEO that had millions of dollars. He'll save him and save her at the same time. God's not impressed with what we have or what we think we are. Because compared to him, guess what? You still going to fall way, way short. You say, well, you don't understand how many doctors degrees I got. You don't know who the head doctor is. He got a capital D, the size of the universe. Capital R with a period. Exclamation point. By his degree. Y'all right? He spoke everything to existence. When's the last time you did that? Y'all all right? He knows the thoughts of man. Thank God I don't know your thoughts right now. Might not be much Christian love in here. Amen. Let me move on. Where we at? Only in love number 5. Now remember, this is what love is not. It is not puffed up. It doesn't bring itself around. No, excuse me. It's not puffed up. Next. The Greek word here used to mean to puffed up means to blow, to puff, to paint, to inflate. Listen to this. Oh my goodness. We're trying. You ever met a prideful person that loved themselves? Matter of fact, they're so prideful and so in love with themselves, nobody else could love them. Anybody ever met anybody like that? Well, that's not what God's love is. Matter of fact, isn't God's love the opposite of pride? Isn't it humility? The Bible says he humbled himself to come in the form of that which he created. To identify with us. So we could identify with him. He did all that because he loves us. His love is a love of humility, not of pride. All puffed up, buttoned up. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Anybody ever seen anybody puffed up in love themselves? Most people. We use the word conceited. Anybody ever met anybody conceited? Boy, y'all should have known Brother Sam before I got saved. My wife used to say this thing before I got saved. I hope she won't say this anymore. I was the most conceited man alive. You could put my picture by the word conceited. I got to believe that's the reason I lost all my hair. What y'all laughing at? God has a way of keeping us humble, baby. And if we don't humble ourselves, he'll humble you. I used to think I sunk on my hair back. So. Strut around like an old band. Y'all ain't from the country. Y'all from the country. Man, I thought I was it. Puffed up. Blown. Make myself in believing that I was something more than I was. Thank God he killed that guy. He created the man. It's humble. I know who I am. I'm nothing apart from Christ. I'm definitely. There's no good in me at all without Christ. Christ is my hope and glory. There is no doubt in my life. I know without a shadow of doubt who it is that's changed my life. And so love is not puffed up. It's not prideful. It's not full of self-esteem and conceit. Look at this next one. Love does not behave rudely. The word lovely means to conduct ourselves improperly or disgracefully. At Circle K, y'all tell I stopped at Circle K a lot? Quite long ago, about 8 weeks ago, 9 weeks ago, I was at Circle K up here on Highway 90, and I walked in, and I was getting me a green tea. And all of a sudden, I heard this man carrying on a commotion. I almost say, manager, I mean, did y'all know you were wrong? I mean, he's shouting. I turn around and look, and lo and behold, I recognize the brother. Matter of fact, the pastor of a church in our community. And I mean, he's throwing him one more hissy fit. Y'all know what I'm talking about? I mean to tell you, son, I thought to myself, good Lord. Now, there's one thing with getting your point across and doing it with love a lot. There's another thing, badgering your point, driving home your point.
and just downright becoming rude.
Y'all right? Boy, I have to watch it, Brother Matt, in this one. Boy, I get talking politics, you can see Christian love go out sometimes. Now, I know none of you fine people I coach you, but this one after you. He told me he got up at 4 o'clock this morning and said, God changed your sermon at 4:30, it must be for me. I said, no, you got this. You don't have to worry about this. Well, I tell you what, you get talking politics with Christians, you find out where their Christian love goes in a hurry, don't you? Like the way they talk about people and the way they act rudely and disgracefully. Just because they got a right to, because they're American. Hey, before you call yourself American, you might want to remind yourself you're called a child of God.
Amen.
That supersedes everything else. That takes precedent over everything else. Just because you're here in America and thank God you're here in America, thank God you've got the greatest right in the world to say what you want when you want, but it does not give you a license to be rude in the bounds of what you say. Y'all all right? By the way, why is it your husband that been rude to you when you're talking to you? I didn't mean for that to come out there. They good to my buddy Chad. He didn't for all the Hey, you know what the Bible says, a kind word? A kind word. A merry heart worketh like a good mess. Do you know sometimes just talking nice to one another and defuse a situation? I didn't know that amen thing. I don't know that. Man, somebody should have said amen from some kind of personal experience somewhere. Not in my eyes, Brother Sam. Bless God, she said it. It's a nuclear oxygen in our house. We need to go off and we say things and we have to make up. Where if you was just kind to one another, there's that word kind. Not being rude. Can you disagree and not be rude?
Yes.
We used to be that here in America, but now everybody wants to prove their point or whatever. Not much love and all that. And by the way, don't you get tired of it and you just want to turn it off? I'm done with that. Well, in your relationship with one another, can you reach that point where you just can rude to one another so much that finally you just turn it off? Used to be the number one reason for divorce in 1970s was lack of communication. And usually that's a lack of talking to one another and reasoning one another in politeness and in love. When I left them, they were taken by the other, so we won't talk about that. What it says here, I'm in the text. Y'all see this? It's in your Bible. Love, verse 4 says, does not pay rudely, does not seek its own. Love is not selfish. Look at your neighbor and say, love is not selfish. Woo, that just messed up our Christian love. Yesterday we was handing out carnations. I told him, I got the car. I've never seen so many bookies in my life. Go up to a house, hand out flowers, and there'd be little bookies. And I was like, good gracious. I got home last night and I literally thank God for reminding me of the lost state of our community. We got good people here in Ocean Springs. Thank you, folks. You just don't know Jesus. I mean, they live in nice homes. They treat your children good. They love one another. I mean, they're good people. But listen, folks, they don't have the love of God. And it's up to you and I to express that God's love is not self-centered or selfish, that it is freely given to all. And once again, it's our responsibility to show that love, to give that love to others. We're supposed to love the unlovable, just like Jesus loved us, the unlovable. We're supposed to give that love to one another. I'm ashamed to say that the first 7 years of our marriage, I was not a husband. I had the ring and I had the position, but boy, I was terrible at being what I was supposed to be. for the last 20 or almost 30 years now, I've tried my best to allow God to change me. One of the areas that He changed me is that I ought to want to serve my wife like I serve my Lord. I ought to want to give to my wife as much affection and as much effort as I do my Jesus. Because the Bible says, likewise, you husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. The sacrificial love. And one of the ways that you can do that is by expressing that love by serving her, doing things for her. Doing things so that she don't have to do it, just so that she can have some time off. It's giving. Serving. My Jesus sure served me up a plate of love every day. It's not selfish. Woo, look at this. I'm still in verse 4. You still with me? Verse 5. Excuse me. Is not provoked. The word provoked here means provoked to anger. It's associated with emotion anger. You go to Proverbs and it says something like this. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger. You ever love somebody so much that you had that love-hate relationship? Anybody know what I'm talking about? Have you ever done anything in your relationship and you based it on love and it just turned out to be just one big blow? I believe God said His love was kind. Now, I'm going to get these next two. Look at these. Verse 9. Verse 8. It says, but not verse. It's point 8 and 19. I'm getting that. Does not provoke. Look at this. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity. Can I tell you something about God's love? God does not love sin. Iniquity. Breaking of the law. Lawbreaker. I wish they had time. But here's your homework for next Sunday. Go read 1 John chapter 3 and 4 about John writing and saying, child of God, when God is in you and His love is in you, child of God ought not to sin. By the fact, the child of God ought to view sin totally different because the love of God is in you. God don't like sin anymore. He doesn't tolerate it. He don't justify it. He doesn't wipe it away. It's just saying it's a mistake and that everybody's going to do it. God does not view sin in the same context that I see many Christians viewing sin today. God says if the love of God is in you, it's different than the love of the devil that is in you. The devil loves evil. The devil loves iniquity. The devil loves breaking the law. There's not a law he won't break. He loves evil. He loves wickedness. He loves sin. When you and I get saved, something ought to happen to us. The love of God ought to wash over us. The love of God ought to indwell us. And our attachment to sin should change. That guy at Home Grace, not long ago, said, bro, so I want you to sit down and talk to me about marriage counseling, being my wife. I said, all right, so I took some time after I got through teaching to sit down and I said, tell me what you have to do. He said, well, me and my wife been living together about 6 years. I want to be a good husband. I said, you want to be a good husband, get married, make a commitment. Y'all right? I mean, the Bible says the husband's the result of a marriage, a ceremony before God, recognizing that God put a man and a woman together. Y'all right? Well, here's our idea today. Well, we just and here's what you'll hear. Here's what I heard. Both saying we got children together. We love one another. We just want God to bless them. When you want God to bless it, you want the love of God to wash over. And it can't wash over it as long as you're loving the sin more than you're loving the God. Now, y'all shaking your head saying amen because that ain't one that you're guilty of. Y'all all right? But what about those sins that you and I embrace, those sins that we walk around and live out in the world and that we're just comfortable with because we don't see it as sin. We don't see it as evil. We don't see it as wickedness. And so my sin is not sin because it's not as bad as your sin. Boy, y'all look mean now. Even Brother Gary dropped his head. Must have got one. I pulled it away. Got it. I'm just kidding. Gary, you know I'm joking.
I'm going to get Gary, brother, son.
Had you done not today. Look at verse number. Not verse number, it's point number 10. I'm about done. Said verse 6, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Now there's a shift. He's told you everything that love is not. Now he's going to shift back to everything that love is. Love is truth. And true God love loves truth. You ever heard anybody tell you this? Now come on now, y'all help me out. I got to tell you something, man. What I'm going to tell you is going to hurt you. But you didn't know I'm telling you because I love you. Anybody ever heard that?
Yeah.
And you rest assured what they're going to say after that, you're not going to be happy with. You will know why, because it's probably true. They're going to say, I love you, but you just tell them. Like, if you love me, you're going to tell them. But in reality, it's truth, and I'm glad she told me. In marriage, our relationship is supposed to be founded on truth. What is the number one thing you must have in your marriage? Trust, honesty. All those are associated with truth. We tell our kids, anybody ever told your kids this? I kind of stay in line. Now, you do something wrong, you tell me, because if you tell me the truth, I can take the truth better than I can lie. Just don't lie to me. Tell me the truth, and we'll be all right. Then when they walk up to you and tell you the truth, you go, oh, boy. Call me, boy, I need to tell me the truth, and I can tell you the truth. Oh, we just had one drink, and he just told you the truth, and played a party, and now you're at home alone. You're going to take them down to the AA and to the rehab, and... Y'all, you do the very thing you said you're not going to. By the way, who is truth? You know what God's saying? If you got my lovings, you can't help but rejoice. You got to love you some truth. Me and Linda, we went to marriage counseling night after I got saved, but we needed it because I did a bunch of stupid stuff. We went to marriage counseling, we went to all of my pastor and went to other pastors, and one of the things that they taught us, he said, you got to build that truth back. You got to build that truth, man. Your truth has been broken. You just got to have truth. And so y'all got to learn to tell each other the truth, even if it's painful. You got to agree to just get it out and share it and just let it go. Practice forgiveness if you need to, but just share truth. So we started doing that. Now that I call him as pastor, and the first time we was in this room together, and I remember the day, I don't know if Miss Bruner remembers, but I was in this room right here, was doing something. And I said something flippant to my wife, and she turned and looked at me, what she just said, disrespectful, dishonoring to me, I don't like what you said. And I looked up, and there was Miss Bruner, her eyes as big as saucer. And I mean, tell you, son, she looked at her mouth, I fell, I didn't want to tell her that it hit the floor, but it almost hit the floor. She's like, my pastor and his wife is fighting. We didn't find out. I just said, I'm sorry. You're right, I'm wrong, I'm sorry. And we went on by our business. I was the end of it. The end of it. She didn't get me home. It's like, you get that, nah, nah, nah. She did all that stuff. She said what she said, when she said it, write it out. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says, don't let the anger, the sun go down on your anger. The Bible says you're going to deal with stuff in truth. I'm on point 11. Y'all liking this? And by the way, they're all right out of the scripture.
Yep.
And right there, y'all see?
Yes.
You can know them. He says, we rejoice in truth. Look at this. Bears all. The word bear here means to cover. Anybody ever heard this scripture? Love covers a multitude of sin. You ever heard that? Aren't you glad that God's love covers our sin? You know what this is. What Paul is saying is, don't forget that the love God has for us, God's love bears all things, which means He covers it. I just wanted to have you keep the notes. If you're not, I understand it's a long time. Forgiveness. That's what Paul's talking about. Paul was talking to the church in Corinth. He said, we got all this division, we got all this bitterness, we got all this anger, we got all this stuff going on in the church. You're saying it's God's love and you're motivated by love and all this, and it's nonsense. It ought to be a love of God is bearing of all, it is forgiving. You won't try something in your house that's burning tricks on your marriage. Try forgiveness. She just said, yeah. Y'all get that? I heard that for the first one. Write it down in your book. I said, yeah, in church, brother Sam. He said, love's forgiven. Boy, what has happened to us forgiving one another and forgiving each other and forgiving people we love? There is so much bitterness in the church today. People just so bitter about what's been done to them, or the wrong, or it didn't go their way, and it didn't turn out the way I wanted it to. And you know what we really do? We want everybody to react and respond to us the way we think they ought to respond and be like. And when they don't, we get hurt. It's just the same. I believe you can move on. Bears up. I've heard some things in my family from my kids that made me want to snap. Y'all know what I'm talking about? And then the love of God wash over me and you say, oh, you can bear this. Because I got you covered and I've got them covered. They're dealing with truth and you're dealing with truth. We just know you can bear this because I can bear. I can bear. Give forgiveness. Move on. Where am I? I'm going to point 11. Beautiful. Good verse. Believes all things. Can I give you a word? I'm just going to give you a phrase to define what this means. This is love looks for the best in everyone. God's love looks for the best in everyone. That's what it means to believe. Have you ever said that I believe in that person even when they're doing everything wrong? I mean, you mamas know what I'm talking about. How about them precious grandbabies? I'll change my preaching when I get one. Tell them we don't get one. I'll be the reason God. Poor grandbaby can't do no wrong, right? Even when they're doing wrong, and you look at it, you know it's wrong. You say, I believe in that child. Y'all all right? That's what that phrase means. You know what God does? He looks down at us and says, well, I believe in you. I believe my love is washing over them. I believe my love is going to overcome them. I believe. Even though they're not doing the best things, the right things right now, I still believe in them. I've got to believe in us. Even when we're making a big mess of it, He's always looking at the best of us. Isn't that good? Well, shouldn't we look for the best in people?
Yes.
I'm looking for the best in you. I found it. I found it. I know what it is. You try to keep it covered up, but I know what it is. I'm looking for the best in you. Well, if a pastor walked around and just looked at the worst of their people, well, I'd be a mess. Well, I just want to look for the best, amen?
Amen.
That's what God said. Look at this. Look at this one. Believes all things. Look at this. Hopes all things. What does that mean, Brother Sam? Look, here's what it means. Let me give you a phrase. Looks for the best outcome for everyone. Look for the best outcome for everyone. You ever seen somebody going through something and you really wanted them to get the best out of it, even though it looked like a bad situation like at the time? You ever walk through that with your kids? Making decisions about jobs and careers and spouses and all that, and you're loving that child, and then you're watching that child make decisions, and you're like, that's a bad one. But I'm gonna leave, I'm gonna hope. My love for them is gonna keep hoping that they're gonna get it right. They're gonna make it right. They're gonna make a good decision. You might know about that. Did you know that's the love God has for us when He looks at us and says, He's about to. Boy, I sure am hoping you get it right. I sure am hoping you get it right. Change that decision. This making sense to anybody? That's God's love. Shouldn't we have more hope in others? Didn't say we had to agree with them. Didn't say we had to like it. What should we?
You ever heard anybody say, I'm always looking for the positive?
Change the word from positive to a scripture word. I hope. My hope. I like my hope to be in good things. Let me go to the next one. We're almost there. Look at this. Love endures all things. This means to bear under, to sustain without complaint. Y'all ever heard anybody complain all the time? I know it's not y'all. No one in this room would be guilty. I understand. So let me talk in hypothetical. You can't tell somebody you love them and all they ever hear you do is complain about who and what they are. I think the first thing God told us about His love is His long suffering. Go back up to see verse 4 if you didn't get it. I know we've talked about 10 things to hear, but long-suffering is patient. This means to endure without complaining. Some of you wives need to understand, you're not going to change your husband. You need to pray God change him. And that you're complaining about everything he does is not going to change him. It's going to make him dig his heels into the ground. And he's going to be like a mule. He's got children or something. Y'all all right? Grumbling and complaining does not associate them in a man's life with love. Now, ladies, I'm just trying to help y'all with something. Tell you something about men. Men are very, very prideful in their position as a man. And all you do is nag, complain, and grumble. Look at y'all laughing. He's not going to equate those three things with love. He just ain't. Not good English, good preaching. She probably goes to work every week as a teacher and say, y'all just won't believe in our teachers. Don't watch them online, you'll have to radical error. Brenda can help you with that first 6 years here I go over preaching. Endures all things. I have resolved in my life that the love of God will give me the endurance. I'm not going to give up and quit on Him. But He'll give up and quit on me. I read a little scripture one time up here. Did you ever read that? It says, do all things unto the Lord without complaint. I lived a long time ago, but my God saved me and given me more than I ever deserved, and I don't have a right to complain about anything my God has. Now here's the last one. 15, and I'm done. 5 minutes over. Verse 8 says, love never fails. The word fail means to fall out of, to cease to exist. You ever heard a couple say, I've heard this all my ministry with people that go through divorce. I'll hear a man and woman come into my office and say, Brother Sam, we just fell out of love. I said, well, you can't fall out of something that's genuine, it's God. Y'all don't? Because God's love never fails. It does not ever cease to exist. It is eternal. Are you listening? It is eternal. My wife and I may not always agree about everything. She may not like what I do, what I say. She may not like what she does and what she says. But I'm telling you this, because of the love of God in me and the love of God in her, our love will endure for eternity. It will never fail. We've been through hard times, we've been through rough times, and I tell you without a shame, tell you, God's love has never failed. We've had heartaches and disappointments and pains, and we've had suffering. But let me tell you what I know, God's love has never failed. We've had up times and down times and in between times, but God's love has never failed. God's love will never reach a place where it never exists. You can't fall out of something that you have. Y'all know? Usually those couples that come to me and say those things didn't have love to start with, it was love. Y'all know? Big difference between lust and love. You can't fall out of something that you've got. If it's there, it's there. Now it may diminish or it may fall and value to you, but if it's there, it's there. And I tell you what, you'll endure, you'll put up with a lot of stuff, and you'd be willing to work through a lot of stuff because that love is there. I told y'all, I'm not ashamed of me and my wife in counseling. Therapy. I had to admit things to pastors and people that I knew. Had to admit things to her that were painful and hurtful. Well, y'all know. But I tell you what, because of God's love, being a love that always exists, that is eternal, God's love never failed. He did exactly what He said He would do. It would change me. It would change us. It would overpower and cover all that other stuff. Boy, has God been faithful for 30 years. My wife and I don't have an earthly love. We have an eternal love. A love that will last forever. She's it for me. Y'all right? Anybody I would get after her would be a counterfeit love. She's it. I've maxed out with eternal love with my wife. She's going to be my wife in the end. Shoot, I know I'm hers. I know I'm hers. She ain't never put up another man. I've got that up for all. I ain't worried about anybody else. Said after that, I survived that. I don't want to certainly go into another. Now look here. I'm done with 15 points. Isn't that amazing? We got through it. Miracle. My wife didn't believe it. I have to rebuke it. We get on. Carried in leader, so I'm not y'all pulling in the lane. That's your sister. She loves you, but. Hey, I start off by saying, boy, our nation has a great need, Debbie. Well, I tell you what, I was in our community this weekend, and I just remind us, Ocean Springs, Jackson County needs love. And this is kind of love we're talking about. We're not talking about, man, you know, people come into our church, and we need to be committed, but now we don't need to lose focus on people come in. You know what the number one thing people say about our church is? Number one is prayer. Well, let me tell you what I've learned about spiritual gifts. Spiritual gift, the gift of hospitality, is a result of people that love. That's a spiritual gift. And people come in and say, man, I was, that church was so friendly. Everybody was so generous and kind and loving. Did y'all know people are saying that they see the love of God in us? It ain't us. We're not generous by nature and kind. Right? It's God. I tell you what, if you've ever been in a godless church, you know the big difference. I just want to challenge us today. By the way, Valentine's is Tuesday, right? Guys, make sure you go. My wife did mine for me yesterday. She told me about this morning, didn't give me a chance to get it. She went and got it yesterday. I appreciate that. Amen. I appreciate that. Amen. That's where about Tuesday, huh? Valentine's Day coming up. I didn't do this. Y'all know me. I don't do sermons with holidays and all that stuff. It's a God thing. But I'm telling you, there is such a lack of love, and it's the responsibility of the Church of Jesus Christ. It's our responsibility to have this happen. Because this is. Now, he told us what his love is and what his love ain't. So if you're living here today and you hear today, you say, Brother Sam, when you went through that list of things that aren't love, my heart was stirred. My heart struggled because there's some areas in my life that's kind of where I'm at. Here's the love of God being extended towards you. You ready? You're just one confession, repentance away of letting that love wash over you. Forgive you, show the kindness and generosity of God through forgiveness. But you're going to have to humble yourself in love to our God. And say, God, I'm not loving the way I ought to. Maybe you and your wife are not in a relationship that you ought to be. Maybe you and your neighbor, you're not showing neighborly love the way you ought to. Neighborly love's the same love. He said, Bible says if you love your neighbor like you love yourself, you ought to be loving your neighbor like you and Jesus love one another. Maybe you're not loving your neighbor the way you ought to in Christian love. Maybe we need to show more love to one another. Whatever the case may be today, I don't want you to leave today. We need to go out there to a lost world and show them what God's love really looks like. We can't do that if we're not in love with Him. Head bowed, eyes closed. Father, speak into heart and change lives in Jesus. And Sharon, make the way to come to play. If God spoke in your heart today, maybe there's a matter in your own life, maybe it's in your family, maybe it's with a loved one, maybe it's with a church member here. Maybe it's with your neighbor. Do you love them like God loves them? Are you expressing and showing the love of God the way you are to? The head bowed, eyes closed, and sitting here, sharing with you what it's meant. Would you come this morning? Maybe you need to kneel down and say, Lord, let me love like you love. Maybe there's a sin in your life that you're letting it stand in the way of your love with God. Maybe there's some envy, jealousy, maybe a little bitterness, unforgiveness in your life. Just keeping you from loving the way God loves. Maybe you've been a complainer too much lately. Maybe you've been moaning and groaning about what God's allowed to happen to you in your life. You've been moaning and groaning about complaining. That's not enduring. God spoke in your heart, would you come? Thank you.
We're moving.